Assalaamu alaykum wa rahmatuallahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science with Professor Zaghloul El-Naggar. Doctor, at the beginning you were speaking about some of the misled scientists, and I was thinking, is the Holy Qur'an providing any sort of boundaries of thinking for scientists, or is it providing more than that?
You see, actually, if you read the Holy Qur'an, you could see many controls and regulations about the activities of thinking, of analyzing, of looking and meditating. You see, even the fair Westerners who speak about the history of science admit clearly that the scientific method, which is wrongly related to some Westerners, they say that the scientific method is purely a Quranic method, because the Quran is always asking for the evidence, for the proof. The Quran is negating judging by whims and personal whims, you see, and conjecture, you see. The Quran is always asking, present your proof. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ. You see, and the Quran is defying the fact that one would follow blindly in any area, not necessarily the area of religion, in any area. You have to use your faculties, you have to use your senses, you have to use your brains, you see. And that's why the Quran laments completely, أَفَلَا يَتَفَكَّرُونَ أَفَلَا يَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ أَفَلَا يُبْصِرُونَ. Don't they even see? Don't they even think? Don't they even meditate? Don't they even reflect, you see? So really the scientific method is basically a Quranic method. And that's why it was introduced by the early Muslim scholars. And they try to relate it to some Britishers or the other, you see, which is completely unfair and untrue. So the Quran has laid down the rules and regulations of indulging into any scientific endeavor, any way of thinking, any way of analyzing anything. So the controls are there. We have to stick to it.
Okay. Okay, moving to you, Abdurrahman and Muhammad. Abdurrahman, do you have any further questions related to the creation of earth and the sky?
Well, in this verse, the word used in Arabic to refer to earth is al-ard in Arabic, which may refer either to land or earth. What do we mean here? Does it refer to planet Earth or to all the planets? Or?
No, you see, Earth here means our planet. Hmm. The planet we are living on. But the word al-ard, meaning Earth, comes in the Quran with three different meanings. Hmm. If the Quran is comparing the Earth with the moon, for example, or with the sun, or with the constellation, it's the total planet. If the Quran speaks about vegetation and the influence of rain on the soil, it is the soil section. If the Quran speaks about al-ard, the meaning of places you are living on, or places that are rifted or affected by deep falls, it's the outer rocky layer which we are living on. So we have these three meanings: the total planet, the continental masses we are living in, and the soil section that's covering the continental masses. And the exact meaning can be understood from the sequence of the verse, the context of the verse. Yes.
How about, you have mentioned earlier that there are seven layers of earth.
Yes.
Does that refer to planet earth also, or to another? To
you see, our earth is actually composed of seven enveloping layers, seven different levels, you see. The internal structure of the earth says that there is a solid inner bowl of iron and nickel, which is known as the solid inner core of the earth. And then we have a liquid outer core. And then we have four layers of mantle. And then we have the outer rocky cover of the earth. Any earthquake, natural or experimental, can define the boundaries between these seven different earths very precisely. Because the sound wave, or the shock wave, as it traverses from a highly dense body to a lighter or lesser dense body, it breaks. So it defines these boundaries very precisely. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has actually mentioned this. He said in an authentic hadith, من اغتصب شبرا من هذه الأرض خسف به يوم القيامة إلى سبع أرضين. Whoever would snatch a hand length, you see, from this earth unjustifiably, unlawfully, he will be thrown down to the equal distance, equal area, you see, from seven earths. ويقول طوقه من سبع أرضين. He will be surrounded by the same area from seven different earths. Or خسف به إلى سبع أرضين. He will be thrown down to the same area from the seven earths. And he صلى الله عليه وسلم is also quoted to have said, إذا سجد المؤمن وصلت بركة سجدته إلى الأرض السابعة. When a true believer prostrates, the blessings of his prostration reaches the seventh earth, which implies that these seven earths are enveloping each other. They are all within this earth, and the outer one is enveloping the inner one. And inasmuch as we have seven earths enveloping each other, we have seven firmaments enveloping each other. And as I said earlier, Allah created in the beginning one earth and one firmament. Then he differentiated this one earth into seven earths and differentiated the one firmament into seven firmaments.
Okay. Doctor, yes. You said that Islam actually uplifted the science, which was kind of dead in the Dark Ages. You heard about the Dark Ages.
Yes.
And Islam and the Muslims, who, with the knowledge of this Quran, which was revealed in Mecca, they uplifted the scientific knowledge.
Yes.
And to my mind, an example of algebra, which is the basis of mathematics, comes to me. Can you please put some light on this?
Actually, although this is a little bit away from what we are discussing, but I would like to emphasize the fact that the Islamic civilization was the longest and the most integral civilization in the history of humanity. Why do I say that? Because it continued from the early part of the 7th century until the 18th century. Muslims were the bearers of the flag of scientific knowledge in every field for more than 10 continuous centuries. And this never happened before in the history of humanity. Secondly, the Islamic civilization was the only civilization that took this world and the world to come in one equation. See, currently, all humanity is suffering from the fantastic scientific and technological developments which is paralleled by negation of religion, moral decay, dissociation of the society, many wars and many fightings, many bloodshed, many injustices that are taking place in this world. And actually, man can destroy himself by developing scientifically and retreating religiously and morally and ethically.
Okay, any further questions, Muhammad or Abdurrahman?
I have a small question. Some people would say if we establish a link between science and Quran, there could emerge a problem in the future because, as you know, science is always developing.
Yes.
I mean, if there is a scientific theory now, it could change in the future.
Yes.
And if we link the scientific theory to Quran, we would say that this theory or the Quran was wrong, and this is also...
You see, I wrote a small booklet called قضية الإعجاز العلمي في القرآن الكريم وضوابط التعامل معها. The scientific inimitability of the glorious Quran and the controls on dealing with it. And I put 20 different items in the process of controlling how to write, how to deal with topic. And the most important one of them is that in the area of scientific inimitability of the Quran, I cannot use a theory. I cannot use a proposition. I have to use established facts. Because this is an area of challenge to Muslims and non-Muslims alike. And if you are challenging, you have to be standing on solid grounds. I cannot use a theory because a theory may fail, may be proved incorrect. You see, but I have to use established facts. And when science reaches the level of a fact or an equation, you see, it does not revert. You see, it can be enlarged, it can be expanded, but it does not go back against its own principles, you see. So in the area of scientific inimitability of the Quran, one of the conditions is that you should never ever use a theory or a hypothesis, because these are liable to fall down. I can only stick to established facts.